Happy New Year! And just like I know many of us have New Year's resolutions that we will forget in a week, I wanted to do some horror New Year's resolutions, or more so just overused tropes that I'm hoping that in 2019 I will see less of when I watch some horror movies. So here's my 5 overused horror tropes that I hope we don't see more of. Hey y'all, it's your Twisted Girl Next Door here, and you know, I don't do New Year's resolutions, but I thought to myself, if I was thinking about what I love, which is horror and dark fantasy, what would be resolutions that I would hope that horror and dark fantasy stories, films, TV shows, and whatnot would eventually follow and leave in the previous year? And I came up with these. And be sure to stick around for number 1, because I think it's one that all of us can universally say we are tired of seeing. Number 5, bad villain slash killer explanations or origin stories. Okay, so this is why this is number 5, because it's not so much of so bad, but sometimes I see it where I'm like, man, this is such a great story, this is cool, this killer is smart, they're doing so much things, and then when the revelation comes as to why they are the killer or what made them do it, it's like, oh, that's it? You know, it's just this idea where it feels like, it just feels a little convoluted. And it's like, it's sometimes, it's better just not to give a villain killer explanation at all. Sometimes that's the most creepy, that people will just do what they do for the heck of it. As opposed to, whoa, it was that one time you kicked my dog? Yeah, I did. So now I want to kill you, your family, and the whole entire town. So either give them really good explanations or origin stories, or just leave it mysterious. It's okay. We don't need to know everything. Number 4. The black people die first, and or there are no people of color anywhere in this story. You're going to be like, why are you on your soapbox? I'm always on my soapbox, y'all. Y'all should be used to this by now. But this is what I mean. I'm not about forced inclusion, okay? I'm not about this idea that if it makes sense that there's nobody, you know, of color or something around, that you insert some random black person there who just happens to be walking by. Yeah, there's Tony. No, I'm more so for if this story takes place in New York, if this story takes place in a college town that is a diverse city and things of that nature, it just seems lazy on the part of casting, on the part of the people writing the story and things of that nature, not to include the way the world looks at this moment. I mean, one of the things about horror that I love is that it's usually a skewed or more so accurate mirror of the society we live in. And sometimes the fears and the extremes are taken to another height, but it's really a reflection of our own very logical fears at times, or illogical fears, but it's a reflection, right? And I think you do a disservice to your story when it calls for it to probably be diverse, if you didn't go out of your way just to make it so, like, not. But what's worse than that, and this goes into the same trope, to me, what's worse than that is tokenism. And it is the year 2019 at this point of the time of me filming this video, and we still have that. We still have it so the black person or the person of color, usually the one person of color in the entire film, is seemingly the expendable one. No. And I know what you're saying, but you've got Jordan Peele now, guys. No. It does not just rest on Jordan Peele to make it so that all characters that are included are treated as like equal human beings when it comes to the value of their lives in a slasher flick or a horror film. 3, obviously stupid mistakes by the characters. I think that if a horror film really has stakes in it and you really make it so that it is, you know, a real issue, a real problem, then you don't need to make it so your characters or the majority of your characters make stupid decisions all the time to keep the story going. I've seen this way too many times, and I think in recent horror films where I'm just like, you know, with everything that we have, yes, I know there are stupid people out there. I know there are people that make dumb decisions. I know there are people that still check a noise in a dark alley when they really just shouldn't go investigate. I get it. Those things still happen. But I don't think they can happen to the majority of the cast to the point where that's the only thing that keeps your plot line going. 2, this is a big one for me, guys. The overkilling of women and usually them still needing to die half naked. Let me preface this by saying I love boobs. I really like mine. This is the thing, though. If you're going to kill somebody, you need to do equal opportunity. I think it's one too many times, and this has been a continuous case, and this is why I'm going to keep saying it, right? But it's one of those things where I've seen one too many times, and it's not like 1980s slasher flicks anymore. I'm seeing them still recent movies where the women have to die so humiliated. You know, it's like she's got to die in just her panties. She's got to die with just her boobs and no shirt on. And the guys, yeah, I've seen guys get brutally beaten and killed and things of that nature, but it's never in such a gratuitous way as in mainstream horror films, as the way the women usually are made to die. I have this term that I have, and I don't think I invented it. I probably heard it somewhere, called horror porn, where it's really, there's no plot, there's no story, because we all know, you know, like pornos, if you watch them or whatever, where it's the pizza guy, and suddenly you forget, I don't have a tip. Well, here's your tip. You know, like, there's no story there. You just want to get to the sex. And I feel like horror porn is very much like that, where it's like, there's no plot here. We just want to get to killing people. And usually thrown into that is we want to get to killing women in a such an overkill sort of way with their boobs hanging out because someone might get off on that. Stop making stories for people who get off on that. There's just not enough equal opportunity nakedness. I mean, not that I want to see peen in every horror film, but if you're going to keep showing boobs, and I mean like humiliated then killed, and I'm talking about there was this B movie, I'm just going to call it out, Thanksgiving, where the turkey rapes a woman before it kills her. What are you doing? And my number one overused horror trope. This one is dear to my heart, and I think you will agree with me. Does the dog die? Stop doing that. Stop killing animals to drive home the fact that your killer or your villain is really a killer or a villain. We know he's a killer or a villain because he's killing and being villainy to humans. Like, I have seen one too many movies recently where an animal is just introduced simply to be killed off later. In fact, to the point where when I see a dog or when I see a cat or a pet be emphasized in any sort of way in a film, I get a bad feeling in the pit of my stomach because I'm like, oh my gosh, we all know why they were put in this plot line right now because they're going to be killed off later. You know, this is one of the reasons why I love the John Wick movies. Yeah, because it's basically like, yeah, stop doing that. We don't want to see the dog killed. In fact, we're all John Wick. Stop killing the dogs. What did you think of my 5 overused horror tropes? Do you agree? Let me know. Comment down below. And also let me know some of the horror tropes that you're tired of seeing. Also, be sure to subscribe so that you are the first to know when I post my videos of all things horror and dark fantasy. Thanks for watching. Let's get creepy together.